everyone. Good evening. Welcome to Beyond Focus Neil. I am your hostess for tonight. As you know, before every show, I'll introduce to you the subject of the show. Tonight's show is with Miss Marie Yolene Urseb. She is the founder, I love the way she put it under her name, Firestarter of Community to Community, an organization that are helping people in Haiti get themselves together to reorganize after the earthquake. We're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. Back. Before I took a break, I told you I was going to introduce to you Miss Marie Yolene Urseb. I love saying that name.
Thank you.
Welcome, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on your show.
Well, you are welcome for coming here. One of the things that, you know, the producer, Dunwan, and I, we've talked about is we've noticed how there's a whole lot of organizations in Haiti or here helping Haiti. There's over 500 registered organizations that we know of. And then we wanted to kind of like talk to people and find out the reason why there's the goal or the need or the drive for it. So from the start, I wanted to get first a little information about you as a person and then so I can tell the public what it is that you're doing within the community. So
sure. Well, obviously, we've already said my name, Marie-Yolene Urseb. I'm originally from Haiti. I was born in Port-au-Prince and moved here with my family in the 70s. Can't remember anymore. But no reason to date myself. Okay. And basically, you know, had a regular childhood and had just dreams to go to college and all sorts of things. Fast forward to moving to New York to be an actor and a teacher, and was working at American Express. And the earthquake happened.
Okay, and let's stop right here.
There we go.
All right.
That's like the short version.
That's the short version.
That's the shortest version ever
of
my life story.
I kind of wanted to get to that part because you've made like a wild decision. You know, because to some people it is very intense to say, oh, you know, I want to help. Like a person like myself, I want to help. I want to donate. I want to give things. But you did differently. So you quit your job.
Yes.
You resigned literally, and then went head on. So can you tell us a little bit about, like, how did you get to make that decision and why?
I remember the day that it happened, how I left work and it was fine before. And when I got to Brooklyn, the whole world had changed, but I didn't know that. So when I got home, you know, I usually do my usual just unwind, you know, thinking about dinner and things like that. And my phone had all of these messages on it. And I still hadn't turned on the TV, so I still didn't know what was going on. And there were like 18 missed calls and everything, so I flipped the phone and I called my brother, I think it was, and he was like, are you okay? And I'm like, I'm fine. And he said, do you not know what's going on? I was like, no, apparently there's something, you know, and then I thought of like maybe something happened to someone in my family. And so he's like, turn on the TV. And when I turned on the television, I was just devastated. I couldn't imagine, first of all. I mean, I heard him say earthquake in Haiti, but I think a few things came to my mind. I thought about my uncles, because usually, like a lot of Haitian families, folks go to Haiti in the winter. They leave right after Christmas, right? And then they stay there till about March, April. And my uncle had done the same thing. They'd gone down to Florida and then left for Haiti soon afterwards. So I thought about him. I thought about my father's brother. And so then it was on the phone, online, trying to find out something. And it was just harrowing. It was hard to focus and function. And I just talked to him. He just left, and this was something he did every year. So there was no reason for me to think, was this the last time I was going to talk to him? So there were, I went to work the next day, and many people at my job knew that I was Haitian. So they were asking me, and it just became overwhelming with the whole CNN all day, and
all
then
day.
Trying to keep my mother off of CNN all day. And when is he going to call? And I just held on, because my uncle's a very tenacious person. So I knew that if there was a way for him to get to a phone, he would
have.
So we just waited. So I think it was about 4 or 5 days later, we heard from the first uncle.
Okay.
And then a couple of days after that, we heard from the second. But then
I was afraid of, I was afraid to ask.
Well, I mean, I don't know anybody who didn't lose someone. We did have a cousin who, although they could hear her, the house fell on her and her two kids, and they couldn't get to them in time. So she heard them calling for her.
Wow.
And they couldn't get to her, and she couldn't get to him. They were young, 4 and 5.
Oh my God.
So that was hard to take. But many people lost a lot of people.
Family, yeah.
So we just, and I kind of went to work in a daze, I think, after that. And I felt,
I think we all did. If you're Haitian descent, you could not possibly, I mean, people normally just could not function with that.
Right.
With that
right.
type of scenario, that disastrous, because it was so cruel. It was in your face all the time.
Yes.
So I understand the position, you would go to work in a daze, totally different for me. I work within the community, so I get to see, mm-hmm. The regular people going through their own, situations every day. I work within Kings. So the first group of people who were coming from Haiti were coming to me. It was, in a way, my sense of relief. But how did you get to decide, okay, you know what, I need to do this?
I think I was sitting in a meeting and I just felt, I can't really describe it in words. I felt like I can't stay here.
Okay.
And I felt compelled to go. I felt released by God to go.
Okay.
And I went to a friend of mine to tell her I was leaving. And it was very funny because at first when I felt like I can't stay here because I can't focus mm-hmm. anymore, and I also felt like I wasn't doing enough. And, everyone got the same calls. Utande? Isku utande? Everyone, mm-hmm. did you hear? Have you heard? Mm-hmm. Did you hear from your friend? Everyone is making the same phone calls. And also, we're watching mm-hmm. the television, and they're talking about the millions and billions of dollars that are going
yeah.
down there.
Yeah.
And then we're talking to our families on the phone, and our families are like, we don't know what you're talking about, but no money is here.
Yeah.
So I just felt like, if I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it now.
Yeah.
So I submitted my resignation in May. I started thinking about it around March.
Okay.
And then I got peace, I would say, around April. Mm-hmm. And in May, I walked into my boss's office and I just said, I have to go.
Okay.
And submitted my resignation.
Because I think that takes a whole lot. I mean, for me personally, I know, I have a lot of my friends who are going to take 2 weeks leave of absence, and then people who couldn't get the 2 weeks off, people mm-hmm. who couldn't get a week mm-hmm. off, you understand, who mm-hmm. wanted to volunteer time mm-hmm. and then wanted to be a part of something. I think that's how I got through it. Fortunately for my family, we didn't lose anybody, but my brother
Thank
was in
God.
Haiti, and he came back with my nephew, who's only 9 months old, and everybody else was safe. But mm-hmm. I would say, no matter how safe you were, or you came back, or you are alive, you stayed, you do either whatever else you had to do, there was some part of you missing. I've always believed that. I think as Haitians, we're hit so badly that it has tremendously have this impact on us. So mm-hmm. when we're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back to talk about that impact and how you take that impact and make it a positive situation.
Okay.
Okay? We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. Took a break. We were talking about how Miss Youssef mm-hmm. made the changes of leaving her company, your big,
corporate job,
and then making the decision to go and volunteer in Haiti. In all seriousness to it, though, mm-hmm. how did you, after making that decision, because I think that would be relief for you mm-hmm. in terms of, okay, so then you took it to the next step, and then you created this organization, Community to Community. First, while reading it, I had all this wow ideas. How did you come up with that, the name, first of all?
I would say that was a lot of prayer. Mm-hmm. From the beginning, when I had the thought, several of the folks who helped me make the decisions were some mm-hmm. of my friends at work.
Okay.
Talked about it a lot. And I'm glad that I had the support mm-hmm. of those folks who really helped me. There were two women in particular, Jamie Kelmanson and Lucretia Robinson,
okay.
who were my support while I was there, and who encouraged me It was like you said, there's a lot of conflict. Mm-hmm. You feel guilty. You feel like you need to do more. You feel you don't know what to do. And I had other friends who were just like, I want to go down. I want to go now. What should we do? Yeah. But I knew I wasn't a first responder. Okay. I knew if I went down there and I saw dead bodies all over the ground, I can't say for myself that I would be strong enough to do that.
Okay.
But I did feel very strongly that there was going to be a second wave of people that were going to be needed. And I felt very strongly that we were in that group.
Okay.
So as a result of that, once I made the decision, it was about putting it together. And I will be honest with you, God gave me the name, God gave me the strength, God gave me the inspiration, God gave me the peace in order to do it, because I was stepping out on faith, that was for sure.
Yeah, I mean, literally.
Yeah.
Literally.
You know, so you...
I mean, it's one thing to say, I'm taking a leave of absence for a month, but to say I'm going to resign and then putting myself within this organization. So, I mean... Just tell us a bit about the organization in itself. What do you guys do? Where are you guys at right now?
Well, when we first left, it was myself, my best friend, Alona Dotson, and my brother, Tony. Mm-hmm. So we went in August of that same year.
Okay.
And during that time, we went to Petit Goave. That's where my dad was from. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to go to a place where, you know, we had some roots.
Yes.
Because what people don't understand is that 8 months into the earthquake, the Haitian people already knew that they had already been either used or the people weren't going to come back with the promises that they had made. Mm-hmm. So, excuse me, it was difficult to get people to talk to you on the street. They didn't want you taking their pictures because they had already
Everybody
been told, let me take your picture and I'll get you a house. Or let me take your picture and I'll bring
I'll
you food,
etc.
But they never saw those people again.
Okay.
So for us, it was a little bit challenging.
I'm so glad that you bring that up.
Well, it's
because
the
that's the reason why I want to do this whole bringing up the whole 500 organization that's right here in New York registered, having fundraising after fundraising after fundraising, and then
what?
So exactly, and nothing
is
being done.
To talk
so
about
I
that.
Really, really. So let's go back to.
I'm happy to have that conversation.
No, two things that I wanted to kind of like talk about. Like one of them is, I know you get this question a lot because I'm part of two different organizations, and people are like, why there?
Mm-hmm.
Why Petit Goave?
Well, I would say for several reasons. Number one, because of the fact that Port-au-Prince, there was just too much going on, and I didn't feel that we had any contacts there that we could just go and get to work, number one. Number two, we wanted to make an impact in a place where we could manage that, and Port-au-Prince has a lot of people, and it requires a huge undertaking, and there are thousands of organizations already there.
Thousands. I know.
I think the latest statistics is that there is one NGO for every 1,000 Haitians.
I know.
Which is a scary thought. But that's probably, I'll come back for another show.
Yes.
We can talk about that.
We need to talk about these things.
That takes the whole time.
I need to relocate the money.
So we went specifically to Petit Goave because I wanted to be in a place where I knew people and that we could implement a pilot project that we could work there.
Yeah.
So we already had roots there, we knew the people there, and so that's where we went. When we got there, we visited six tent cities, and out of those six, we chose three to work in. Because anyone who is doing this work will tell you, you can come down there and give out a dollar to everyone.
Exactly.
But on Tuesday, you'll have to do the same thing, and on Wednesday, you'll have to do the same thing.
So explain to people the whole self-initiative idea, because I think we although this is a half hour show, and I think we should do this for a whole hour because of the simple fact that we need to let people understand the concept of your organization. So the whole help, you know, like
it's building self-sufficient communities by working with the community. One of the most profound things that the people told us, because we went on a listening tour, we wanted to hear from them, where is the money? How come you all aren't getting it? And why is there this disconnect? And one of the things that they said to us was that they, and I assume they're talking about other
organizations
that come down, they build on us, they build around us, but they don't build with us.
Okay.
They talk around us, they talk about us, but they don't talk to us.
Which is interesting.
Right?
Yeah.
And at the end of the day...
It is the truth.
It is the truth. There's no... It is like me coming to your house and walking in and saying, you know what, I'm going to do this in blue, and we're going to do this in red, and you're looking at me like...
Yeah, so this is your little bed.
And why are you in my house without my permission?
Yes.
and changing my house. And that's different than me knocking on your door, mm-hmm. asking if I can come in, and then saying to you, well, we have some ideas that could help, but you've lived in the house for 10 years, so how about you tell us what you think, and we will work together to make it better.
Okay.
That's what we're doing. We're working with the community in order to make it better. That's how the Haiti Restoration and Transformation Pilot Project
started.
By community to community started.
Okay, so we're going to take another break, and then we're going to talk about the three things that you are working on really strongly, and because the... Like I said, we don't have like an hour show, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
But I want people to understand what you guys are doing within Haiti right now. And so we'll take a short break. Welcome back. I am here having a great conversation with Marie Herseb. She is the founder of Community to Community, this great organization that's working within Haiti right now. So before we took the break, we were talking about the Three Men initiative of your work right now in Petit-Goab. So,
The Haiti Restoration and Transformation Pilot Project actually has four initiatives. The three specifically that you're talking about are the water, the school, the road, and reforestation.
Okay.
In April of 2010, we launched the water. Okay. And the reason we did that, many people was like, well, why didn't you start the school? Water is life.
Yep.
If people have cholera and they're dying, they're not going
to school.
Okay? So I had to make it plain because many people were just like, oh, we have to educate. Yeah, but if the children are sick and they're dying, they're not going to come to school.
Okay.
So, and also, we spoke with the community, and that was their main request.
Mm-hmm.
So the reservoir that was in the area where we were working was damaged by the earthquake. So they had actually drawn up plans for us, and I want people to know that too. It wasn't that we necessarily brought plans to them. They had engineers and technical people in the town, in Petit-Goab, mm-hmm. who had drawn up the architectural drawings for the school, for the road, for the reservoir, and they already had a papinier, a nursery, mm-hmm. that they had already started their reforestation project themselves.
Okay.
So we came to work alongside them. So after we launched the water initiative, what that entailed was finding a water source.
Mm-hmm.
In April of last year, they were almost in a drought, hadn't had rain in 7 months. So when the rain did come, we were able to find now two sources. And as of today, actually, where the captage is, mm-hmm. the water is coming out at 6 gallons per minute.
I saw that. I was
we're very proud
yeah.
of that, because that was, it's on a mountain. It's difficult. It's not like you can run across the street to Pathmark and, mm-hmm. and get water. So now that we've secured the water source, the next phase will be to build the water tank to secure the water
mm-hmm.
and to store it, because the rains will come again and the cholera will come again.
Okay.
But once we have stored the water, then it can be used for irrigation. It can be used within the community.
Mm-hmm.
Another challenge is that people are walking 3 and 4 hours to get to the water.
The water. Yeah.
So we're now building 4 kiosks that mm-hmm. are coming out of the water tank in different directions within the community so that folks don't have to walk as far. And we're talking about children.
Okay.
Babies who are literally walking with buckets on their head, and elderly people as well.
I have a quick question, because we are like at the end of our show, so I want to get these points across.
Okay.
Is there a time for frame time that
mm-hmm.
You expect in this the water project to end, the school and
the water is actually wrapping up this quarter.
Yay.
Yes, and then we're heading straight into the school.
Mm-hmm.
We actually have one main fundraising effort that we are using for that.
I know
you miss your sad.
Oh.
It's okay, it's annual.
I did.
It's gonna be fun. We did our first Hope in a Future benefit concert at the mm-hmm. Apollo at the 1 year anniversary of the earthquake, and we just completed the second Hope in a Future at Walt Whitman Theater this past January 13th at Brooklyn College, your alma mater. I'm told.
I'm like, ugh.
Right on. So, and we're already planning. We will be actually back at Walt Whitman, so you won't have to travel far. That will be January 11th, 2013, which is also, incidentally, the 350th anniversary of Petit-Goab.
Okay.
So it's going to be a wonderful celebration. Folks can go to our website,
www.community will be able to get in touch.
I'm happy to share. Okay, so everyone listening, everyone watching, and thank you again for the opportunity to be here on your show. You can find out everything you need to about Community to Community by visiting our website, www.community2community.info, or you can call us at 718-393-7740. We are looking for volunteers. We're looking for folks who have backgrounds in medicine, in engineering, architecture, production, everything you can imagine. We can find a place for you. Come help us and be a part of something greater than yourself.
You know, it's one of those things that, you know, before we started the show, I was talking to you about, like, you know, I don't know, I'm a big fan of Oprah.
Mm-hmm.
So I was watching
yes.
her show on Haiti, and mm-hmm. then people were talking about, like, why did she wait so long to bring it up? And I think what you said earlier is that you've waited to be part of the second draft, because a lot of times we are first runners. We're like, we want to fight. We want to, and then after that, it just kind of dies down.
Right.
But
right.
to find an organization that, you know, while reading your mission, it says you want to be an umbrella.
Yes.
You know, for other organizations who wants to work within Haiti.
Mm-hmm.
And I think putting that idea out is really significant, because people want to work. They want to, like, yeah, I want to have an NGO. I want to do this. But then, you know, the plan is there. The idea is there. The funds being raised,
mm-hmm.
but nothing else is being done. To have an organization I don't know Sean Penn personally, but mm-hmm. I would say someone who like decide make a decision to leave his comfort zone
mm-hmm.
and
for
go
sure.
to Haiti and volunteer his time, or someone who live like you quit your job,
mm-hmm.
leave all of your comfort to just go to Haiti and work on behalf of the community and itself. Is very significant. It's more significant than a person like myself who's just like, oh, you know, I'll send $10, I'll send $20, I'll send clothes. You understand? So for me, these are the decision makers of the future of Haiti. You know, the people who are making decisions to better Haiti. So tomorrow we will have like a Haiti that we had before. The Haiti that I remember
yes.
growing up with. You
yes.
understand? So
I agree.
I really applaud your work. Within this, it's unfortunate that we are meeting right here, like days after you had your concert. I'm like, I was so upset. I'm so upset at myself. But you know, like you said, there will be other times. There
yes.
are other ways that we, besides putting your organization's name out there, can help rebuild this. So if you need any volunteer, like besides my people watching, can volunteer their time. If you need me to do anything,
you are more than welcome.
Yeah.
Everyone, I like to say to folks that. Do what you can where you are with what you have now. So whether that's the $10, that's fine. Whether that's volunteering, that's fine. If you can't go, but you can make sure that you purchase a ticket for a teacher or an architect or a medical person who can go, that's just as important.
Okay.
'Cause then when we all come together at the concert next year, I may meet you and say, thank you so much
yeah.
for making it possible for me to go down there. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Everyone has a role to play.
So one of the things we didn't talk about is like, is there, like if people wanted to donate,
mm-hmm.
is there a donation in
right on the site?
Right on the site.
Right on the site. They can go and they can either send it via mail. That's
mm-hmm.
also on the site as well if they wanted to do that. They can do the PayPal. And one of the important things I want to point out to your viewers is that when you go to the site, there's a link right there at Giving to the Communities that says see where your money went.
Yes.
So you can see our in progress report to see exactly where we spent the money. You can see the 15 latrines. You can see the pictures of the people working, building the water tank and building the papiniers and building the road. You can see all of those things going on, working with our partners like Adiha, Fashion with a Conscience.
Yes.
The things that we say we are doing, we have tangible proof that we are doing it.
Which is extremely important,
mm-hmm.
I think, to people like myself, because I'm like, I'm a seer. I want to see it. I want to
mm-hmm.
see things happening. Like, that's why I was so elevated when I actually saw that, you know, he was moving people from the camp
yes.
to an apartment.
Yes.
And for me, that was a moving moment for me, to know that you're building things like water tanks that mm-hmm. people can get better and they don't have to get sick and 2-3 years down the line, there'll be a school, there'll be a road where people can drive. So for me, these are the significant things that are happening, and I really want to thank you. I know this is the end of our show. You know, if there's any last words you'd like to say to the community, I think.
I would like to say that this movement, because that's what it is a Haitian-led movement with those with a heart for Haiti who are helping us. My dad gave me a heart and a love for my country. I'm sure that I'm not the only one who feels this way. I think that if we come together, tête ensemble, as we say, main pile chai palu, with many hands, the load is lighter. So we just ask you, come visit our site, call us. If there are ideas that you have, if there's ways that you want to help, we can all band together, whether it is in Léogâne, Jacmel, Petit Goave, Port-au-Prince, Ocap, it doesn't matter. It's all one Haiti if we work together.
And as a human being, you know, I think it's one of those things that we should like really try to help one another to make this a better world.
Yes.
So we could all live and you know, be happy. Why not help one another? So this is my little, the end of our show. I hope that you enjoyed it because I actually enjoyed talking to you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having
me. We'll see you next Tuesday, same place, same time. Bye.
Be